We are at the beautiful Peninsula Hotel in Beverly Hills, where the surroundings are exactly what the wineries want. Wonderful accommodations, we've got great food, just an excellent location, and everyone in LA knows where the Peninsula is, and it's a fantastic spot for us to pull the very best of wine together.
My wife and I moved to Napa Valley to raise our children, and made a decision in doing that to develop vineyards. And I was very interested in pursuing a career in winemaking. So we basically started out very small, and I've hired consultants that have trained me. So I've never had any real formal training. It's really been on the job. The blending is always done blind in terms of choosing the final blend. It would be determined on putting out three or four different variations of a blend and not knowing what they are. So I'll instruct somebody else to do a percentage of certain wines, and then we'll taste them not knowing what they are. So we're picking the wine that is most pleasing to the palate, that is the style and personality that we're looking for, and then it's really kind of fun and revealing to, you know, find out which wine, what the actual blend is. But that's kind of how my approach is.
Stars of Napa will have approximately 40 different vintners here tonight, and each of them with two or three, maybe four wines. So when you do the math, our clients get to come and taste over 100 wines, maybe as many as 140 wines. Obviously, we're not encouraging them to taste them all, at least drink them all, but we like them to taste and sample as much as possible, and that'll give them a chance to get a big perspective on a single category, a single appellation, experience the terroir of Napa Valley, and how the different philosophies and expressions of Cabernet and Syrah and Chardonnay and the other wines that make the region of Napa Valley so special.
My great-granduncle was a man named Gustav Niebaum. He founded a company called Inglenook Vineyards. Inglenook Vineyards was a beautiful operation for three generations. So I'm a fourth generation vintner in Napa Valley, one of two. And we have two more generations going in the business right now. So we're six generations into the works. You know, these stories are very important to the wine business. They give the wine business legs, they give it a mystique, they make it fun, and they make it memorable. Not just for Lael Vineyards, but for the business at large. The passions come through, and they go over 130 years. So I think that's a very important thing.
Making great wine is sensory-based, as much as it's science or anything else. And so tasting. And so one year you might, Cabernet might be the best of the four, and you use a lot of that. Another year, Merlot might show better. And that's one of the advantages we have of being able to draw from all these vineyards. And every year we make about three times as much wine as I bottle. And we sell off what we don't use, so we can pick the best batches. Land use issues are very of great concern. The valley in Napa, this is not true in most of the other places where I work. They're not as developed, but in Napa Valley, it's pretty much planted up, and population growth, and using the land in ways that, you know, like building houses on them and so on, is perceived to be counter to the best interests of keeping that area rural. You can't just go somewhere else and start making wine that is good as and tastes like Napa. So if you use it for something else, it's lost. That's an irreplaceable jewel. There is a trend in current winemaking, and it's really fueled by the press, to favor hyper-ripe wines, wines that are very, very ripe. And some of the big important wine writers reward those kind of wines. And there is a big debate as to whether we've gone too far making wines too far in that direction, and making wines of less charm and elegance and finesse. And I think we are making them too ripe. which is why I got on the soapbox when you said that.
I started this as a hobby. We made 200 cases our first year in 93. I always wanted to make wine so I could give some to my friends, and it's grown considerably. Nature's interesting. Nature gives you grapes off of the same piece of land every year, and we own almost all of our vineyards, so we know what we're getting, but the grapes are different every year. We've picked as early as end of August, and we've picked as late as first week in November. So, you know.
We bought a marvelous vineyard in St. Helena, California, and we produce Cabernet and Merlot grapes, and we sold our grapes at first to another winery who was getting tremendous reviews on the wines, and knowing that 85% of the quality of a wine is the grape, I knew we had great grapes. So 2005, we said, enough selling grapes, we're gonna make wine. We make two wines. One is a blend of 55% Cabernet and 45% Merlot, all estate grown. We only use our own grapes, and our winemaker has identified seven different zones in our vineyards, and so he makes a barrel or makes wine out of each of those zones, and then we sit down in the spring and we start blending until we get the quality we want and the aspects of it that we want. I like balance. I like subtle elegance. I like approachability. I don't like big extracted wines. I like wines that marry well with food, and that's what we try to produce.
Learn about wine is a fairly unique concept, because we are not about selling wine. We're about building an event, a special occasion for both the wineries, the trade, and the consumer. So we have a lot of different customers to serve, but in the net result is that we benefit our company through our relationships and our ticket sales and the monies we're able to recoup there. But we're able to benefit charity by building this great audience, this unique environment, and the wineries donate some wine. And we've got tonight we're with TJ Martell, which is a fantastic foundation raising money for children's cancer research. And there's probably 30, 40 items in there, some of them valued several thousand dollars. Our goal is to raise about $10,000 tonight, and we can do these events with a lot of reoccurrence, so frequency. You know, $10,000 sounds like a decent amount of money, but for a charity tasting, we know that a lot of them raise a lot more dollars, but we can do four, five, six of these a year and really not tread on anybody too heavily, and I think that's responsible, and I love to be able to tie in and benefit a charity, give it some recognition, make some friends with the charity, and I think these events do a great job bonding charity, wine, and the consumer together.